Hi, I'm Dr. Brett Heisman, and this presentation is about my research on interactions between autistic people, published in the journal Autism, titled Neurodivergent Intersubjectivity. The study introduces some theoretical concepts and methodological innovations, so to make it easier to follow, I'm going to structure the talk in the following way. First, I'll consider the main finding of the study so that you know what to expect, the motivation for the study, the background theory about intersubjectivity, which allows diverse ways to describe social interactions, the methodology, the findings, and the discussion, including limitations. So the main finding of the study is that some autistic social behaviours that have been characterised as problematic are not so problematic within interactions between autistic people. The motivation for the study came about after observing autistic adults playing video games at an autism charity where I was conducting research. Not only was this a popular social activity, it was also evident that there was incredible social imagination and coordination taking place between players and other observers in the room. Players were imagining each other's perspective, the perspective of characters in the game, and the perspective of fictional characters within the wider gaming genre. All of this creativity might look chaotic to an outside observer, because it did not necessarily follow established norms for interacting, but it was resulting in sophisticated coordination in terms of completing game tasks and a great degree of social rapport for those involved. We therefore wanted to document some of the patterns through which young autistic adults were building shared understanding in this setting. The value of studying a naturally occurring social activity between young autistic adults is that it has ecological validity, and it is a setting where neurotypical norms were not being actively imposed. In terms of background theory, intersubjectivity, literally the bridging of subjectivities, is an important concept in the social sciences, used to describe the process through which people create shared understanding. Intersubjectivity involves layered communication, where people build shared knowledge and experiences, which impact each other's behaviour and opens up opportunities for further interaction. Through interacting with each other, we transform our understanding of ourselves and social reality, which in turn comes to shape our possibilities for future interaction. This process is most easily observable through language, but indeed any system of communication can result in intersubjectivity. Importantly, intersubjectivity is a process because it looks at how communication builds over time, which is different to other models of communication, such as a ballistic approach, where communication is conceptualized in terms of a message reaching its target, which is a common metaphor, but a little simplistic. The value of intersubjectivity is that it tells us more about how people misunderstand, negotiate, and reconcile perspectives. Looking at communication as a two-way, co-constructed process also has the advantage of recognizing how meaning can be interwoven in quite complex ways. For example, any spoken word or action may not seem relevant in the moment, but become useful much later on. Our goal was to use intersubjectivity to describe the diverse ways in which autistic participants created possibilities for action and shared understanding. Methodology. Since the phenomena we were trying to understand was so rich, we had to take a systematic approach to the data, as well as critically reflecting very carefully on our own assumptions and practices. This methodology section therefore covers four topics: conversation analysis, relative flow, pragmatism, and autistic intercoder reliability. In order to map patterns in the data, we follow the principle of conversation analysis, where each turn in a conversation is part of a potentially wider, sequentially organized unit of meaning making. Conversation analysis therefore involves transcribing each turn in a dialogue and looking at how ideas are structured over a wider sequence of action. With intersubjectivity, however, there are multiple ways in which turns may be connected. There's semantic alignment, such as the topics being discussed. There is the emotional connection, in terms of alignment of affect, such as laughter. And then there is the symmetry of how turns are spoken, such as their volume or length. These are three types of intersubjectivity that are commonly associated with language. Of course, there are many more that are possible. We aim to document the relative flow of alignment between participants. The concept of relative flow is important because each group of people are unique, thus the norms for behaviour in one group are not necessarily comparable to another. So instead of imposing an external rating framework to map patterns in the data, we examine each turn in light of the previous turn that had been spoken. We wanted to understand variation within the interaction. Turns were therefore scored in terms of their alignment to the prior turn across the semantic, affective, and stylistic aspects of intersubjectivity. A moving average of 20 turns provided a graphic of relative flow, which could allow us to identify peaks and troughs in tightly coordinated and distally coordinated moments throughout the interaction. 20 turns was chosen as a moving average because it provided a good resolution in terms of identifying the broad peaks and troughs of intersubjectivity. But other moving averages are of course possible, depending on how granular you'd want your analytical detail to be. Beyond the systematic approach, there was also the methodological consideration about reflecting on our own norms and assumptions as researchers. One of the challenges of researching social interaction in autism is that autistic people are often studied from a normative viewpoint, where behaviour is interpreted in light of sociocultural norms. This means that some social abilities may be missed because they appear unconventional. A lack of understanding between people with differing norms and expectations of each other has been termed a double empathy problem, which means that the lack of understanding goes in both directions. Autistic people face a social world that is built on a number of normative assumptions about what is appropriate behaviour, which means that neurodivergent ways of experiencing and interacting with the world can often be curtailed when those norms are imposed. This is also true of researchers who are attempting to interpret autistic behaviour depending on their own expectations and experiences. Our orientation to the data was therefore governed by the principle of pragmatism. Rather than attempting to add value to the data by describing instances of communication as either good or bad, we sought to describe communication in terms of what happens next. This means that we avoid concepts of deeming behaviour to be problematic or imposing immediate consensus as the standard used to measure success in communication. Instead, a pragmatic orientation suggests that coordination of actions can be on a continuum between immediate or distal, i.e. something someone said could become useful much later on. And outcomes may be observable in terms of new activity or new opportunities. This is why intersubjectivity was used, because it is suited to describing interactions rather than attempting to evaluate what is meaningful from the outside. A second measure we used to reduce the potential bias of norms at the level of interpretation was to conduct autistic intercoder reliability. This involved two autistic adults who did not take part in the study, but were members of the same charity, who read through the transcripts and rated each turn according to alignment of intersubjective aspects. They were able to question all assumptions about the data and the rating and provide their own feedback as well. The outcome of all of these steps was that we had a systematic way to map patterns of intersubjectivity in the data. This allowed us to zoom in on peaks and troughs in the flow of intersubjectivity for further qualitative analysis. Of course, there are always limitations associated with any method, which we will discuss further in a bit. Through mapping all of the interactions, two broad features stood out, leading to further sub-questions. First of all, across all interactions, we observed quite rapid shifts between tight and loose alignment in intersubjectivity. Secondly, the different dimensions of intersubjectivity could diverge considerably. We therefore qualitatively explored sections of the data which focus on transitions from tight to loose alignment, and where different dimensions of intersubjectivity diverged. Exploring these areas revealed two properties of intersubjectivity that played a role in developing shared understanding: a generous assumption of common ground, and a low demand for tight coordination. Common ground. Often, participants might make specific references or imitate fictional characters which would only make sense with certain prior knowledge. This rapid changing of topic and style could result in many turns being ignored by their partner, but it could also result in fantastic rapport when reciprocated. Consider example 1. In this example, James and Bruce are playing Call of Duty, Advanced Warfare, when a new enemy appears, projecting a powerful laser from the sky. Neither player were expecting this enemy or its capabilities, but were able to create new language to index the threat and organize action. James initially voices surprise at the laser, but Bruce is distracted by his own character, damaging his health, and does not respond to James's surprise. James adopts a dramatic voice in a second attempt to draw attention to the new threat. Bruce reciprocates stylistically, taking a similar voice of a narrator and indexing the Tron film franchise. This opens up possibilities for rapport, since Tron happens to be a cultural reference that they both understand. Subsequent turns reciprocate understanding of the Tron reference, as players parody worshipping Tron as a god. However, adopting references from the Tron films not only leads to rapport. Later on, when the laser returns, it's James who uses the Tron reference to highlight the new threat. Bruce, the originator of the Tron reference, is then alerted to the danger and is prompted to share his experience about how to handle the threat. Thus, players are able to develop shared language on the basis of assuming shared cultural resources, which allows them to creatively index and orientate to novel problems. A low demand for tight coordination. A second feature observed that enables transition between dimensions of intersubjectivity was a low demand for tight coordination. Autistic participants would not be overly troubled by ignored turns, which created the freedom to switch between individual and cooperative ways of relating to the situation. In example 2, David, who has the controller, and Mark, who is watching and advising, are playing Assassin's Creed Syndicate. To begin with, David, who is more familiar with the game, is interested in how the game has developed new features compared to previous games. Mark, being new to the game, is marvelling at the graphics. Their turns are thus distally connected to begin with, where Mark is more focused on his embodied reactions to the game, and David is more focused on relating the game to past games. While initial topic coherence may be low between turns for some time, they are in alignment in expressing emotions of curiosity and excitement. Eventually, the intersubjectivity reorientates towards topic coherence, as David responds to Mark's observation about feeling queasy, resulting in a sequence of much tighter coordinated turns. Consequently, they establish new shared knowledge about feeling vertigo in video games, and how this can be common for non-autistic people as well. What's so interesting about the data is that these are not two isolated features. They potentially fit together into a functional system that allows rich forms of socially relating, which can explain how rapid changes in interaction dynamic are possible. A generous assumption of common ground allows autistic participants to continually experiment with ways of relating to their situation, and a low demand for tight coordination means that there is minimal negative consequences when specific references are not shared. Example 3 illustrates both of these processes in action. Daniel and Max are interrupted by two new visitors, Graham and Alice. Alice has not met Max or Daniel before. Following initial introductions by Graham, Graham begins to initiate an exit from the room. They discuss what else to do, and it is mentioned that Alice plays the violin. Max shouts loudly across the room at Alice to get a violin and play the Halo theme, which disrupts Alice's move to exit the room. Graham's unsure response shows that he is not familiar with Max's reference. However, Alice does understand the reference because she plays Skyrim and is familiar with the symbolic field of console gaming. Revealing this, "I can do the Skyrim theme," leads to mutually recognized common ground between those present, resulting in rapport building as Alice takes control with a series of one-liners that are familiar to Max and Daniel. Thus, assuming common ground, i.e. Max's very specific reference, and the low demand for coordination, i.e. Alice not being perturbed at being shouted at, which is a sharp misalignment of symmetry and choosing instead to respond in terms of topic and effect, unearths new subjective potential to engage socially which otherwise would not have been discovered. The implications. Some autistic traits that have been previously characterized as problematic are not so problematic in autistic to autistic interactions. Specifically, traits previously characterized as egocentrism can be seen as a generous assumption of what is shared, thus it creates possibilities for rapport and coordination. Traits previously labelled as low reciprocity and a tendency to drift between topics are not always problematic. Indeed, having a more relaxed expectation around social coordination creates possibilities to experiment and switch between individual and cooperative ways of relating to the situation. It is the way that these two features work together to allow distinctive ways of building shared meaning that myself and Dr. Alex Gillespie describe as a feature of neurodivergent intersubjectivity. Limitations. Obviously, these findings relate to just one study, looking at broad patterns in a specific activity of video gaming. There are some characteristics of video gaming that could support some of the features observed. Video gaming involves activity around a shared object of a TV screen, which can help to coordinate attention and realign action if it becomes fragmented. It is also a type of interaction that involves reduced non-verbal communication, as players play adjacent to each other, therefore less effort is spent on interpreting facial expression and body language cues. Undoubtedly, more features of neurodivergent intersubjectivity would be identified when studies include additional communicative features and contexts. In addition, the sample studied involved intellectually able young autistic adults, most of whom were men. Therefore, further studies can help to reveal more about neurodivergent intersubjectivity across wider populations. One question I have been asked before when presenting the study is how the findings might compare to non-autistic video gamers. The reason we did not study a comparative group of non-autistic gamers was that, as a first study, we were very keen to focus on autistic interactions on their own terms, without comparison to a neurotypical benchmark. Often comparative studies of groups of autistic and non-autistic individuals fall into the habit of treating the non-autistic group as the normative group. But norms are relative, and a key methodological contribution of this study is to show the utility of studying interactions in terms of their within-interaction variation, and to recognise that different intersubjective styles are possible. Indeed, in not enforcing a full range of social norms, neurodivergent interaction has potential social qualities that could be learned by neurotypical people. Further research on this would be fascinating. For example, I have seen one study which has shown that a looser demand for reaching consensus was associated with better creativity. Other limitations pertain to methodology. This study was innovating in different ways to create a systematic approach to qualitative data that minimized the impact of neurotypical assumptions. The systematic approach identified here is labor-intensive, so researchers should consider the amount of data, their resources for processing it when using this method, and what supports might be available for automation of that process. In terms of mitigating the impact of neurotypical norms, intersubjectivity is a great theoretical framework that recognizes diverse forms of social relating, and the use of autistic intercoder reliability is something that could easily become standard practice for qualitative studies. But it cannot be assumed that neurotypical bias was removed altogether, and we should always remain conscious of how we can make further improvements to the process of research. I therefore look forward to seeing more research in this area to understand and identify more about neurodivergent intersubjectivity and its potentials for social interaction. Thank you.